From the moment I fell down that rabbit hole, I've been told what I must do and who I must be. I've been shrunk, stretched, scratched, and stuffed into a teapot. I've been accused of being Alice and of not being Alice, but this is my dream. I'll decide where it goes from here.
If you diverge from the path...
I make the path.
Today, we are learning English with Alice in Wonderland. We will first see her meet the Cheshire Cat and then when she visits the Mad Hatter at the tea party. Just click on that subscribe button and bell down below now. Alice falls down a rabbit hole full of objects floating in the air into a room with many doors. Alice enters the door into a vast garden residing in Underland, where she encounters the Cheshire Cat. Before we get into the scene, I said that Alice falls down a rabbit hole. Here, this happens literally, but there's also an idiomatic expression, go down the rabbit hole. This means that someone spends a lot of time on an activity, perhaps more than they originally intended.
It looks like you ran afoul of something with wicked claws.
To fall or run afoul of something means to get into trouble because of not obeying or following a rule or law.
So what's the job?
Yeah, one of our associates ran afoul of some competitors and got himself caught. So I'm putting together a crew to spring him.
Claws are the sharp, curved nails on some animals. If you describe someone or something as wicked, they behave in a way that is morally wrong. It's a synonym for evil or terrible.
I'm just not too keen on killing a lady.
She's not a lady. She's a wicked witch. And your magic is the only thing strong enough to destroy her.
As a slang word, wicked means the same as awesome or cool.
I mean, do you really have the...
The what?
The skull.
Oh.
Yeah. Wicked.
The Bandersnatch is a fictional creature in Lewis Carroll's narratives and also a character in Alice in Wonderland. It appears as a bulldog, bear-like creature and is controlled by the Red Queen. If a cut or other injury festers, it becomes infected and produces pus.
I've been over this. It was too much. I couldn't accept it.
I actually saw this splinter that's been festering for 3 months, an old piece of wood.
Okay, I'll tell you what.
Also, if an unpleasant feeling or problem festers, it gets worse because it has not been dealt with.
It isn't safe. The trees have grown wild and dangerous. Anger festers in their hearts. Black are their thoughts. Strong is their hate.
When something putrefies, it decomposes and produces a very unpleasant smell.
He managed to peel and dissolve some of the stain, but the wound's putrefied. By the time he stops, he was horribly deformed.
In order to highlight the importance of connected speech, let's contrast Alice's statement with mine, but I'm going to say it without any contractions and pronounce every single word completely. I would rather you did not.
I'd rather you didn't.
It's an enormous difference, isn't it? In Alice's speech, we don't hear the pronoun I. The only thing noticeable is the D sound that comes from the contraction of I would. Now I encourage you to try it out.
Why don't we go back to my place, light a couple of candles, break open a box of cinnamon fruit toasties.
I'd rather not.
Oh, yeah, why not?
I'll be fine as soon as I wake up.
At least let me bind it for you.
As we saw in the clip, bind means to tie things firmly together with cloth or string. Another common meaning to the verb bind is to form a strong emotional connection between two people, as in the following example.
The couple has written their own vows. These vows are from the heart and will bind them together forever.
Josh. You are my heart and soul.
What do you call yourself?
Alice.
The
Ange?
Here we have an alternative to the question, what is your name? However, you may hear it more often during formal conversations.
Well, what do you call yourself?
Me.
Yes, you. There's nobody else here.
No. I call myself me.
We normally don't use the definite article the before someone's name. Nevertheless, it's used when we mean specific people.
I'm Alice.
The Alice? The Alice of legend?
Look, you're kind of freaking me out.
You'd best is an old-fashioned way of saying you'd better. This phrase is short for you would or had better, and it's used to talk about actions we think people should do or which are desirable in a specific situation.
What are you two conspiring about? Well, whatever it is, you'd best hurry up. My brother is coming.
To a small council meeting?
If you are on your way, you have started your journey somewhere and leave where you currently are.
Keep your distance. I'll use this if I have to. I don't want any trouble. You understand? Just show me the way to get out of here and I'll be on my way.
Well, there's a lost.
Yes. Yes, and I want to get unlost as soon as possible.
Fine. I'll take you to the Hare and the Hatter. But there's the end of it.
Which picture shows a hare? A hare is an animal like a rabbit, but larger, with long ears, long legs, and a small tail. Hatter is an old-fashioned way of referring to someone who makes or sells hats. The terms milliner and hat maker are generally used interchangeably these days. Strictly speaking, though, a milliner makes women's hats and a hat maker makes men's hats. Interestingly, in English, we have the expression as mad as a hatter that is used to describe a completely crazy person. If you are a fan of Alice's stories, you know that the Hatter demonstrates some degree of craziness in his ways.
Alastor Moody, the Aura.
Aura?
Dark wizard catcher. Arthur Seldon Azkaban field thanks to him. He's supposed to be mad as a hatter though these days.
After her talk with the Cheshire Cat, he escorts her to the tea party where she is going to meet Tarrant Hightop, the Mad Hatter, along with Thackeray Earwicket, the March Hare, and Malimkin. If you tell someone to watch it, you warn them to be careful. Alternatively, you can say watch out. Let's see an example in this clip.
Guys, I don't think this is Elliot sending the text. I think Allison is.
Obliged comes from obligation. If you are or feel obliged to do something, you are forced to do it or feel that you must do something.
Of course they were. Absolutely. And, you know, speaking of which, as your agent, I am obligated to tell you we just got an absolutely fantastic new offer, but that last job...
The expression kill time means to do something that keeps you busy while you are waiting for something else to happen. For example, we killed the time between trains by checking our social media. In Alice's universe though, time is a magical being with whom the Hatter had an argument in the original story by Lewis Carroll. We are going to see that there are plenty of references to it in this scene. If you say that a child is naughty, you mean that they behave badly or do not do what they are told.
You can hardly see us anymore. And the pain stops after a while.
As I told you once before, Mr. Potter, naughty children deserve to be punished.
Well, anyway, time became quite offended and stopped altogether.
Here, altogether means abruptly, completely.
You seem happy?
I'm just relieved to have that whole prophecy thing off my shoulders.
I'm not altogether sure it is, Percy. You've done wonderfully, but you are still the only living human child of Poseidon, Hades, or Zeus.
Tick is the sound clocks and watches make every second. It can also be used as a verb.
Something for later. Because I know how much you need it.
The clock's ticking, my friend. We're running out of time.
Down with is something you say, write, or shout to show your opposition to someone or something, and to demand that the person is removed from power or the thing is destroyed.
Oui, I heard it, my friend!
It's a scandal!
It's an outrage!
Down with the queen!
Down with the monarchy!
Wait!
The adjective bloody, besides being used to describe something covered with or full of blood, is also used to express anger or to emphasize what you are saying in a slightly rude way.
All right. I can see you in this.
You bloody fools. What were you thinking coming here? Have you any idea how dangerous it is?
You're Aberforth, Dumbledore's brother.
Commence is a formal and more advanced way of saying start something.
Don's Nightingale, Brearley, Chapin, and Spence, let us now have this meeting commence.
Don Constance, why is she here?
Slaying is the noun form of the verb to slay, which means to kill in a violent way.
Some may imagine that a noble quest is at hand. A quest to reclaim a homeland and slay a dragon.
We use and such when we want to avoid saying a long list of things, especially when they are similar. Let's take a look at this example.
You and the Wonder have been expected for over a year.
There were complications, pirates and such. The ledgers are in my cabin, and would you please let Lord Ascot know I should like to see him immediately?
Therefore, it is high time to forgive and forget, or forget and forgive.
You use the adverb therefore to introduce a logical result, conclusion, or consequence.
Nothing, I repeat, nothing, gives a student the right to walk about the school at night. Therefore, as punishment for your actions, 50 points will be taken.
50?
Each.
If you say that it is high time to do something, or that something happened or was done, you emphasize that it should happen or be done now or as soon as possible. This is an example of advanced use in English. Pay attention to the fact that we tend to use a verb in the past after this expression, as in this example.
Well, now George will have his say.
Please, dear.
Mary, the child's growing up. It's high time she had a room of her own.
All this talk of blood and slaying has put me off my tee.
To put someone off something means to take their attention away from what they want to be doing or should be doing.
Which one of my superpowers do you love the most? Is it my famous raven cry, or is it just the fishnet?
Seriously? You're putting me off my pie.
Well, I guess it's just my martial arts skills then. Oh.
It looks like you ran afoul of something with wicked claws.
But I'm still dreaming.
What did that to you? The Bandersnatch. Well, I'd better have a look.
What are you doing?
It needs to be purified by someone with evaporating skills, or it will fester and putrefy.
I'd rather you didn't. I'll be fine as soon as I wake up.
At least let me bind it for you.
Which picture best represents someone binding a wound?
What do you call yourself?
Alice.
The Alice?
There's been some debate about that.
I never get involved in politics. You'd best be on your way.
What way? All I want to do is wake up from this dream.
Fine. I'll take you to the Hare and the Hatter. But there's the end of it.
What is the name of this famous fable whose moral is slow and steady wins the race? The Rabbit and the Turtle, the Hare and the Tortoise, the Hare and the Turtle.
It's you.
No, it's not. McTwist brought us the wrong Alice.
It's the wrong Alice.
It's absolutely Alice. You're absolutely Alice. I'd know you anywhere. I'd know him anywhere.
Well, as you can see, we're still having tea. And it's all because I was obliged to kill time waiting for your return. You're terribly late, you know.
Naughty.
Well, anyway, time became quite offended and stopped altogether. Not a tick ever since.
Cup. Time can be funny in dreams.
Down with the bloody big head. Bloody big head being the Red Queen.
Come, we simply must commence with the slaying and such. Therefore, it is high time to forgive and forget, or forget and forgive, whichever comes first, or is in any case most convenient. I'm waiting. It's ticking again.
Oh. All this talk of blood and slaying has put me off my tea.
In which sentence below do we have the opposite idea of naughty? He was obedient to his parents. He is more impish without his parents. She used to be a defiant child.
You used to do the best futterwhacken in all of Wits End.
Futter what?
Futterwhacken!
It's a dance.
Ah, yeah! Today we are learning English with Beauty and the Beast. You are going to watch some scenes from the movie alongside an interview with actress Emma Watson. You're going to greatly improve your British pronunciation, learn tons of vocabulary, grammar, and so much more.
If you're new here, this is how the lesson will work. You'll watch some clips with subtitles, then we'll teach you all of the most important vocabulary, pronunciation, and cultural context before you test everything you learn by watching it a final time without subtitles and answering some quiz questions. Let's get started.
Beauty and the Beast really, if you think about it, is like four movies in one.
A beast is an animal, especially a large, dangerous, or unusual one. In the movie and other fantasy stories, beast is used to refer to beast-like monsters, for example, a half-man, half-animal. By saying that Beauty and the Beast is four movies in one, Emma means that the film can be seen and enjoyed from four different perspectives, which she will explain in this interview. Example: this jacket is actually two in one. It is a rain jacket, but it can also be used in formal situations.
Beauty and the Beast really, if you think about it, is like four movies in one. It's an action movie. We're making a live action film.
In filmmaking, live action is a production that shows real people acting, as opposed to animations or computer-generated effects. The original Beauty and the Beast is an animation. Emma is saying that they were making a live action film, and that it was also an action movie. Recently, Disney has been making lots of live action films of their animated classics. Have you checked out our lessons with The Lion King and Aladdin yet?
There's a huge amount of stunts, and there's wolf fighting and horse riding and, you know, and guns and sword fights and all of that going on.
Stunt is an exciting moment of action, usually in a film that is dangerous or appears dangerous, and usually needs to be done by someone skilled. Here, Emma uses the noun wolf fighting, meaning a fight with wolves. When collocated like that, you can create a variety of different nouns. Example: most people coming to this gym prefer weightlifting over cardio exercises. She also says horse riding, which is also a noun referring to the activity of riding horses. So in another example, if a film wins awards, we could say it is an award-winning film.
It's also a comedy. The comic timing of characters like Cogsworth and Lumiere and Mrs. Potts, it's just hysterical in my opinion.
Comic timing is the concept that things can be funnier when done or said at the correct speed and with pauses. Check out how Chandler, from the TV series Friends, tries to be funny by adding pauses and speaking at a specific speed, which helps his jokes or the things he says to sound more funny.
I went to that tanning place your wife suggested.
Was that place the sun?
Yeah, it's weird. Donald Duck never wore pants. But whenever he's getting out of the shower, he always puts a towel around his waist. I mean, what is that about?
You might have noticed that comedians like Ellen DeGeneres also do this.
You're an amazing actress. You're not one, but two nominated films tonight you were in. That's just, that is so, what is the word for it? Selfish, I guess. I really do think it's an exceptional year.
It's also a comedy. The comic timing of characters like Cogsworth and Lumiere and Mrs. Potts, it's just hysterical in my opinion.
Someone who is hysterical is so excited, angry, or in panic that they start to scream without control. Now, if something is considered hysterical, it simply causes people to become uncontrolled in such a way. Most commonly, we say this to mean that something is very funny and makes you laugh a lot, as Emma does here.
It's just hysterical in my opinion. Then on the other hand, it's a romance. It's a romantic drama.
The expression "on the other hand" is used when you want to give another point or fact about something that is really different from what you said before.
Your mother was there for me at a time when no one else was. Not only was she a singularly gifted witch, she was also an uncommonly kind woman. She had a way of seeing the beauty in others, even and perhaps most especially when that person could not see it in themselves. Your father, James, on the other hand, he had a certain, shall we say, talent for trouble.
Then, on the other hand, it's a romance. It's a romantic drama.
When talking about types of movies and TV series, drama refers to highly emotional ones that are focused on emotional, serious situations and interactions between characters, not on comedy or action scenes. So Emma is saying that the movie is a comedy, but also, on the other hand, is a romantic drama.
Ah, if it isn't the only bookworm in town.
Bookworm is an informal way to call a person who is constantly reading books.
Your father and I have been friends since time began. I've watched you grow up, Indy. I've watched the two of you grow apart. I've never seen you this concerned about him before.
Dad? He's an academic. Bookworm. He's not a fieldman.
Dad!
So, where did you run off to this week?
If you run off to a place, you are suddenly leaving the place you are and escaping to go somewhere else.
The beast wouldn't hurt anyone.
I've heard of the effects of dark magic, but I've never before seen it with my own eyes. This is a threat to our very existence. We can't have her running off to warn the beast. Lock her up too.
No!
Come here!
No!
Shut up!
The man is asking Belle about the story she discovered in the last book she read, and where it happened.
Where did you run off to this week?
Two cities in northern Italy. I didn't want to come back.
So Belle responds that she ran off to two cities in northern Italy. She might be making a reference to the popular story of Romeo and Juliet, which took place in the north of Italy.
Have you got any new places to go?
I'm afraid not.
Although afraid means the same as scared, here, I'm afraid is a polite expression used before telling someone something that might make them sad, disappointed, or angry. Example: will John be there? I'm afraid not. Things haven't been going very well here, I'm afraid.
Of course I came back. I'll never leave you again.
I'm afraid it's my turn to leave.
We're together now. It's gonna be fine.
We have to see Professor Dumbledore immediately.
I'm afraid Professor Dumbledore is not here. He
He received an urgent owl from the Ministry of Magic and left immediately for London.
Have you got any new places to go?
I'm afraid not. But you may reread any of the old ones that you'd like.
Thank you.
To reread is to read something again. Belle has read all the books in the library, and so now is rereading them.
Your library makes our small corner of the world feel big.
The way Belle uses corner here is to refer to an area of a country or land, often somewhere quiet or far away. Example: it's important to meet people from outside of your corner of the world in order to broaden your global perspective.
You need someone at the helm of a movie like this that can really do all of those things.
If you are at the helm of something, you are in charge of it. For example, a captain or pilot. Example: Captain Jack Sparrow is at the helm of the Black Pearl. Emma is saying that for doing such a complicated movie with so many details, you would need a really capable director.
And it takes someone quite special, I think, to get all of that working very well. And I think Bill has done a brilliant job of that.
Somebody that is considered brilliant has great intelligence or skill.
Tony Stark. Visionary. Genius. American patriot. Even from an early age, the son of legendary weapons developer Howard Stark quickly stole the spotlight with his brilliant and unique mind. At age 4, he built his first circuit board. At age 6, his first engine. And at 17, he graduated summa cum laude from MIT.
However, in British English, brilliant is used as slang to say that something is very cool, similar to the word awesome in American English.
It's not much, but it's home.
I think it's brilliant.
We also wanted to give her this element of being quite industrious and quite practical and very inventive.
Somebody who is considered industrious works very hard and consistently. More commonly, we might say hardworking. Example: she is the most hardworking accountant you will ever meet. Somebody who is inventive has the ability to create or design new things or to think originally.
What are you doing?
The laundry.
Laundry refers to both the activities of washing clothes and the dirty clothes themselves. Although you could just say, I have to wash my clothes, native speakers much more often say, I have to do my laundry.
Okay, let's do laundry.
Hey, Sheldon.
Hello.
Doing laundry?
Of course I'm doing laundry. Saturday night is laundry night, and I'm in a laundry room, so...
All you have to do is hit that subscribe button and the bell down below so you don't miss any of our new lessons.
Come.
The blue bird
that flies over the dark wood.
Wood, or woods, refer to an area of land that is smaller than a forest, but that is covered with trees.
That was amazing!
What on earth are you doing?
On earth is used for emphasis in questions that begin with the words such as how, why, what, or where. It is often used to suggest that there is no obvious or easy answer to the question being asked. Example: how on earth did that happen? Why on earth would he want to go to such a place?
The Green Initiative, for only $12 million, will change
okay,
the way...
I've heard enough. Now, don't we already have a Green Initiative? I mean, didn't we do a whole thing, hang a banner, make a video? Sting was there. I thought I met Sting.
You did meet Sting.
Yeah, I met Sting. So why on earth would we spend another $12 million?
Well, because we can always do more.
I can't leave now, Sheldon. I'm very busy. Besides, why would I want to do you a favor after the way you treated me in the cafeteria?
What on earth are you talking about? My behavior in the cafeteria was delightful.
Can you think of an example with this expression? Practice your English by writing it in the comments below.
In the animation, Maurice is kind of the inventor, but in this movie, it's actually Belle who is really forging forward and innovating and coming up with new ways of doing things.
To forge ahead or forge forward is to suddenly make a lot of progress. Somebody who is innovating introduces and suggests improvements and new ideas. To come up with something, such as a plan or solution, means to think about these ideas.
Now, if you two don't mind, I'm going to bed before either of you come up with another clever idea to get us killed, or worse, expelled.
Belle also does some teaching in this film. She wants to, not only does she love reading for herself, but she actually loves sharing her love of books, and she loves sharing the things that she finds special and interesting.
While the most correct pronunciation, which you probably learned in school, of this word is interesting, natives, both Americans and Brits, like Emma, often shorten it, so it sounds like interesting. Notice that it goes from four syllables, interesting, to just three, interesting.
An interesting necklace.
Oh, that's, interesting.
No, it's not interesting, okay? It's very, very not interesting. It's actually 100% completely the opposite of interesting.
All right, I got it, Ross.
This happens with other words, too. How would you pronounce this? You probably said comfortable. While there is nothing wrong with saying it this way, a native would probably reduce this to comfortable, again, removing one of the syllables. This happens all the time, so remember to pay attention to it in your favorite series and movies.
Welcome to your new home. It's modest, but comfortable.
Gotta go, wish me luck.
Oh. Hey, Rach, now that you work in Ralph Lauren, can you bring me back some of those polo shirts?
Well, you know what? I don't know if I'd feel comfortable stealing on my very first day.
Unwilling to steal from work. Interesting.
And she loves sharing the things that she finds special and interesting. And I loved that too, that she wants to share.
A book that truly allows you to escape.
As we saw before, books allow you to escape and live in another reality. So the Beast is saying that this book actually or truly allows you to escape through magic.
The cruelest trick of all. It was just another curse.
In fantasy stories, a curse is magical words said to somebody in order to invoke a supernatural power and punish or affect someone negatively.
It was the cruelest trick of all.
In this case, trick simply refers to a clever or interesting way of doing something. Example: check out this move I learned playing soccer, the hat trick. Somebody who is cruel causes pain and suffering to others intentionally. Cruelest means the most cruel. There is nothing that is more cruel than that. It is the superlative of the adjective. In English, superlatives normally appear as one of these two options. For short adjectives, adjective plus est, example, coolest, fastest, smartest.
LeFou, my dearest companion.
It's beautiful.
But of course, Master wanted you to have the finest room in the castle. Oh dear.
For long adjectives, most plus adjective. Example, most intelligent, most creative, most fascinating.
He taxed the village to fill his castle with the most beautiful objects.
Oui, maître.
And his parties with the most beautiful people.
You are the wildest, most gorgeous thing I've ever seen. Nobody deserves you.
It was the cruelest trick of all. It was just another curse. The outside world has no place for a creature like me. But it can for you.
Did you notice the connected speech here? Beast didn't say, but it can for you. He said,
but it can for you. But it can for you.
We hear two interesting instances of morphing T sounds here. First, the T of but becomes a tap T because it is between two vowel sounds. So but it becomes but it. This is more common in American English, but Brits do it sometimes too, as Beast does here and as we saw earlier.
What on earth are you doing? What on earth are you doing?
Second, the T of it, because it is at the end of this syllable, becomes a stop T sound. It. It.
But it can for you. But it can for you.
Hey, after you finish this lesson, be sure to check out this funny lesson that we made with an interview of Emma Watson on The Ellen Show.
Beauty and the Beast really, if you think about it, is like four movies in one. It's an action movie. We're making a live action film. There's a huge amount of stunts and there's wolf fighting and horse riding and, you know, and guns and sword fights and all of that going on. It's also a comedy. The comic timing of characters like Cogsworth and Lumiere and Mrs. Potts, it's just hysterical in my opinion. Then on the other hand, it's a romance. It's a romantic drama. So, and then it's a musical. And then there's music, just to kind of really add it on the top, music and dance and theatre, really.
Ah, if it isn't the only bookworm in town. So, where did you run off to this week?
Two cities in northern Italy. I didn't want to come back. Have you got any new places to go?
I'm afraid not. But you may reread any of the old ones that you'd like.
Thank you. Your library makes our small corner of the world feel big. So you need someone at the helm of a movie like this that can really do all of those things. And it takes someone quite special, I think, to get all of that working very well. And I think Bill has done a brilliant job of that. We wanted to make sure that we know she loves reading, we know she loves to travel, but we also wanted to give her this element of being quite industrious and quite practical and very inventive.
What are you doing?
The laundry.
Come.
A blue bird
that flies over the dark wood.
That was amazing.
What on earth are you doing?
Teaching another girl to read. Isn't one enough?
So in the animation, Maurice is kind of the inventor, but in this movie, it's actually Belle who is really forging forward and innovating and coming up with new ways of doing things, which I thought was really interesting and was an idea that I loved. Belle also does some teaching in this film. She wants to, not only does she love reading for herself, but she actually loves sharing her love of books and she loves sharing the things that she finds special and interesting. And I loved that too, that she wants to share.
Book that truly allows you to escape.
Amazing.
It was her cruelest trick of all. It was just another curse. The outside world has no place for a creature like me. But it can for you.
Nothing in life ever stays the same. Good or bad. Just remember, when the clock strikes midnight, run.
No! In today's lesson, we are going to learn English with the brand new romantic musical, Cinderella. The film is based on the fairy tale of the same name and star singer Camila Cabello as the title character in her acting debut. Except the story isn't quite the same as the fairy tale, so keep watching to find out why. Join our community of over 4.6 million learners by hitting that subscribe button and bell down below now. Cinderella is an ambitious young woman who wants to have her own shop, dresses Viola one day, in her patriarchal society. She gets Prince Robert's attention at the guard-changing ceremony. The next day, Robert decides to get dressed as a common person in the hope that he will find her out in the streets.
So you're just going to wander about until you find her wearing that ridiculous disguise?
The word wander is quite confusing because it is very similar in both spelling and pronunciation to wonder. Wonder with an O means to ask yourself questions, to think about something because you want to know more facts or details about it. Let's take a look at the examples. I've been wondering about going to California.
Have you ever wondered why Robert makes the process to marry so difficult?
Wander with an A means to walk around slowly in a relaxed way or without any specific destination in mind. It's commonly followed by about or around.
So you wanna like head out, check out the town?
Yeah, let's go wander around. And later on, I think we definitely need to do a little honky-tonk.
Yeah.
It works, Wilbur.
In this context, work means do a job for money, do an activity, to be effective or successful.
Nobody recognizes me.
Lucky for you.
The phrase lucky for you or simply lucky you is used in spoken English to say that someone is fortunate to be able to do something.
They don't know. They don't know what Martin's capable of.
All right, well, lucky for you, your friends at Star Labs do.
You know, I can't believe that you're willing to sully the dignity of the royal family for some commoner.
If someone is willing to do something, they are enthusiastic about doing it and will do it if they are asked or required to.
Well, even though the things you said hurt me a little bit, my point is, I'm willing to take my job back.
When addressing someone from the royal family, the use of formal words is more frequent. This is the case for Sully. If something is sullied by something else, it's damaged so that it's no longer pure or of such high value. Also, if someone sullies something, they make it dirty. Alternatively, you can say ruin or stain.
You can't tell anyone you're staying here, okay?
Are you worried you're gonna sully my reputation?
You know, I can't believe that you're willing to sully the dignity of the royal family for some commoner.
In countries which have a nobility, commoners are the people who are not members of the nobility. As the film takes place in the Middle Ages, we are shown the different classes represented at that time. A social class even lower than a commoner would be a peasant. A peasant is described as a poor person of low social status who works on the land.
I rose him up from nothing. I will not kneel before some barefooted commoner and beg his forgiveness.
It belongs to a peasant, Your Highness, who only pretended to be a courtier to save a man's life.
Yes, I know.
Well, but you sound old.
I'm just what? She's beautiful, she's witty, she's fearless.
Someone or something that is witty is funny in an intelligent way. A common collocation is witty banter, which is a conversation that is funny and relaxed. If you say that someone is fearless, you mean that they are not afraid at all, and you admire them for this. Likewise, you can say brave or confident. Take a look at the examples.
It's as if someone really wants us to be together.
Someone does. Me.
Oof. Witty banter. Well done.
That is so easy for you to say. You're fearless.
I am so not fearless.
And holy hell, did you see the way she talked to my father?
Holy hell is an exclamation of great surprise or horror.
This is an interesting expression because people change it in various ways, like holy moly, holy crap, and holy cow.
Wow, it is raining cats and dogs out there. Holy moly.
Look, sir, we are very busy here, and I just... holy crap!
It is the very prison whose corruption John Decker was investigating when he was murdered 16 years ago.
Holy cow.
And holy hell, did you see the way she talked to my father?
Prince Robert asks this question extremely fast. It's a great opportunity for you guys to practice connected speech. In order to facilitate the flow of speech, you can connect did you see and omit the final T sound in talked, as the next word already starts with a T sound. Let's listen one more time and repeat along.
And holy hell, did you see the way she talked to my father? And holy hell, did you see the way she talked to my father?
So mouthy.
And glorious. I must know her.
If you say someone is mouthy, it means they talk and express their opinions a lot, especially in a rude way.
And I'm going to keep getting better till I'm the best you've ever seen.
Oh, you're mouthy. And you got guts.
So yes, I'm going to walk the streets until I find her, reveal my true self, and then personally invite her to the ball.
Ball is a large formal occasion at which people dance, and the place where this event happens is called a ballroom. The type of dance people perform here is known as ballroom dancing.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished visitors and people of our land, the prince who now chooses partner for the first dance, let our ball commence!
And as of course it turns out that she's got a couple bats in the old belfry.
We use the phrase turn out when things happen in a particular way or to have a particular result, especially one that you did not expect. Example, it turned out that I was right.
I spent all my childhood pretending I was off somewhere else. Off with you on one of your adventures. My own adventure turned out to be quite different.
Unless, of course, it turns out that she's got a couple bats in the old belfry.
Prince Robert used an interesting idiomatic expression here, but first let's understand what belfry is. Belfry is what we call the tower for a bell, especially on a church. To have bats in the belfry is an old-fashioned idiom and means to be silly and slightly crazy and behave in a confused way. More up-to-date alternatives to this expression are klutz, nutty, and flaky, which are all slang.
It is your belfry that has bats.
I do not have a single bat in my belfry.
No, there are multiple bats in your belfry.
I am the prince. In which case, I will realize that my feelings were incorrect.
And slowly back away.
In which case, or that case, is used to indicate that what you are going to say is true if the possible situation that has just been mentioned actually exists.
A Dalek is honest. It does what it was born to do for the survival of its species. That creature in your dungeon is better than you.
In that case, I will be true to myself and continue. And slowly back away.
If you back away, you walk backwards away from someone or something, often because you are frightened of them.
I wouldn't back away from what's right just because it's hard. My father used to say, plant your feet and stand firm. The only question is where to put your feet.
Cinderella's dream of having her own shop starts with her trying to sell a dress that she has made with her own hands at the local market. However, things don't go as she expected. People didn't put so much trust in her and she even got ridiculed. That's when Prince Robert shows up and strikes up a conversation with her.
Sounds like you need to lower your price.
Sir, please don't pile on, okay? Not today.
Cinderella is angry and frustrated because she was ridiculed as she tried to sell the dress. She became tired in that situation and told the prince not to pile on. Pile it on or pile on the drama means to talk about something in a way that makes it seem much worse than it really is. It's easier to understand if you consider the literal meaning of pile, which is a group of several things of the same type that are put on top of each other or the action of doing that. It's like when an uncomfortable situation is happening and one keeps piling other bad things onto it. Take a look at this example.
Well, if you think that's stimulating, you should see him with some candles and a ball of red wine.
You know what, Missy? Why don't we have you meet some of the patients? The nurses can tell you all about the top-notch service here at the hospital. There you go. Hey, do you mind not piling it on, please? I'm already having a hard enough time. I don't like talking to the media. Okay, you gotta watch everything you say.
Relax, okay? You're doing great.
Another interesting use of pylon is to refer to this action.
I should be allowed to sell it.
Sure, but women can't own shops.
Throughout the Middle Ages, lower class women had mostly domestic responsibilities, including caring for children, preparing food, caring for farm animals, and sewing. During the busiest times of the year, such as the harvest, women even joined their husbands in the field to bring in the crops. In the scene, Cinderella expresses her indignation because she wants to break this pattern.
Uh-huh, and that's unfair.
Is it?
Yes!
An unfair system or situation does not give equal treatment or equal opportunities to everyone involved.
The prince is not free to marry for love. He's promised to the princess Shalina of Zaragoza. The Grand Duke told me himself.
It's so very unfair. We run households. Surely we can run a business. Can't be that hard.
One of the meanings of the verb run is to organize or be responsible for an activity, business, organization, or country. The word household refers to the house and the people who live in it.
Are you sitting high up in the Sierra Mountains and you're drinking, what's he drinking?
Champagne.
Champagne cocktails. And you're passing judgment on how I run my family.
I could hang my garments on that side and I'd say things like, thank you, come again.
Garment is a formal way to say a piece of clothing. If you hang your garments, you put them in a position so that the top part is fixed or supported, and the bottom part is free to move and does not touch the ground, and in order to do that, you can use a hanger.
This garment cannot possibly be a part of my wardrobe.
Or hot enough out there for you?
Hot?
It's banter. It breaks the ice? Okay, what am I doing? I'm going home.
Let's understand how banter is related to the question, hot enough out there for you, and to the expression, break the ice. Banter is a conversation that is funny and not serious. Banter is also used as a verb. For example, you can banter with your colleagues at happy hour. If you break the ice, you make people who have not met before feel more relaxed with each other. Is it not hot enough for you? Is the kind of question people might ask during hot weather with the intention of breaking the ice and starting banter with someone.
Morgan likes to embarrass me, so I'm not letting you two hang out together anymore.
See? Threatened.
Don't let the friendly banter fool you, Joe. We really can't stand each other.
The dress. I'll buy it.
Is this pity?
Pity is a feeling of sadness or sympathy for someone else's unhappiness or difficult situation. A common collocation is to take pity on someone, which means that you feel sorry for them and do something that shows this.
Not for the first time, Ella actually felt pity for these two schemers, who could be every bit as ugly within as they were fair without.
Besides, she's working a tough gig. You know, she's exhausted. You should take pity on the old.
That's really nice.
I'm just trying to do my part to correct a flawed system.
Flawed is the adjective form of the noun flaw, which means a mistake, mark, or weakness that makes something imperfect. If you describe something as flawed, it's not perfect or contains mistakes. The flaw that Prince Robert is referring to in this clip is the one that didn't allow women to have their own shops. If you want to express the opposite idea of flawed, all you have to do is add the suffix less to flaw, and then you have a synonym for perfect, flawless.
Keep a memory of me. Not as a king or a hero, but as a man. Fallible and flawed.
What's your price? I mean, the brooch alone.
The question, what's your price, may be ambiguous depending on how and when you ask it. It may state your intention of offering money to someone to do something illegal or to obtain some sort of advantage. As we can see in the scene, the prince rephrases this question to make it clearer that he wants to buy the brooch.
I mean, the brooch alone.
Oh, the brooch. That was my mother's.
A brooch is a small piece of jewelry with a pin at the back that is fastened to women's clothes. You can also find it spelled this way in American English, brooch.
Evening, ladies. Oh, I like your brooch. What is that?
Oh, it's a koala bear. I think they're adorable.
I'll pay triple what you're asking.
You.
Don't judge a book by its cover, m'lady.
As the prince is not dressed in fancy clothes, Cinderella might think that he does not have the money to buy the brooch. Thus, he used the saying, don't judge a book by its cover, which is said to show that you cannot know what someone or something is like by looking only at that person or thing's appearance.
What's this?
It might not look like much, but never judge a book by its cover, you know?
Don't judge a book by its cover, m'lady.
Milady, from my lady, is used to address or refer to an English noblewoman. The masculine form is milord.
All men are fools, that's what mama says. The sooner you learn that, the better.
The first dance, milady.
So you're just going to wander about until you find her wearing that ridiculous disguise?
It works, Wilbur. Nobody recognizes me.
Lucky for you.
No, too much.
What, the makeup?
Yeah, you look like a pirate.
You look like a pirate.
Unnecessary.
You know, I can't believe that you're willing to sully the dignity of the royal family for some commoner.
Which picture best describes a commoner?
Wilbur, you sound old.
I'm just...
Just what?
She's beautiful, she's witty, she's fearless.
And holy hell, did you see the way she talked to my father?
So mouthy.
And glorious. I must know her. So yes, I'm going to walk the streets until I find her, reveal my true self, and then personally invite her to the ball. Unless, of course, it turns out that she's got a couple bats in the old belfry, in which case I will realise that my feelings were incorrect.
And slowly back away.
Sounds like you need to lower your price.
Sir, please don't pile on, okay? Not today.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. It's a beautiful dress.
Right? I should be allowed to sell it.
Sure, but women can't own shops.
Uh-huh, and that's unfair.
Is it?
Yes! Us ladies give birth. We run households. Surely we can run a business.
In which sentence below does run mean to organize or be responsible for an activity? My family runs a restaurant in a traditional neighborhood of the city. I need to run to the store for some more eggs. She got out of the car and left the engine running.
Can't be that hard. I mean, wouldn't it just be great if I could have my own shop? Right here, I could hang my garments on that side and I'd say things like, thank you, come again. Or, hot enough out there for you?
What?
It's banter. It breaks the ice. Okay, what am I doing? I'm going home. I'm talking to a stranger.
I'll take it.
Take what?
The dress. I'll buy it.
Is this pity? Are you doing this because you feel sorry for me? Because that's really
no,
nice.
I'm just trying to do my part to correct a flawed system.
Which words below are synonymous with flawed? Impeccable? Faulty? Defective?
What's your price? I mean, the brooch alone.
Oh, the brooch. That was my mother's. I never knew her, but I want to believe she'd rather me have my dreams than her brooch, so.
I'll pay triple what you're asking.
You.
Don't judge a book by its cover, m'lady.
Are you ready for a power-packed lesson? Today, we're learning English with Avengers Endgame. At the end of the previous movie, Avengers Infinity War, Thanos managed to collect all six Infinity Stones. This gave him immense power that he used by snapping his fingers. This was a catastrophic event, as the snap produced a massive amount of power that wiped out half of all life in the universe. We've seen this word before in previous movies. It means to destroy life on a planet or part of the universe.
Is the Tesseract. It has the potential energy to wipe out the planet.
There's always an alien battle cruiser or a Carillion death ray or an intergalactic plague that's about to wipe out life on this miserable little planet. The only way these people get on with their happy lives is they do not know about it.
Hey, we'd be going in shorthanded, you know?
In this scene, the Avengers have figured out where Thanos is located, and they're set to find him.
So where is he?
When Thanos snapped his fingers, Earth became ground zero for a power surge of ridiculously cosmic proportions. No one's ever seen anything like it. Until 2 days ago, on this planet.
Thanos is there.
Banner is worried they would be going in short-handed. If a company, organization, or group is short-handed, it does not have enough people to work on a particular job or for a particular purpose. With two of his stars out due to injury, the team is a little short-handed, but still hopes to win.
Our whole future depends on this one school, and you bring in amateurs.
In case you hadn't noticed, we're a little short-handed.
I hope you didn't send all your fancy enforcers, because that would leave you a little short-handed around here.
Look, he's still got the stones, so...
So let's get him. Use them to bring everyone back.
Here's another verb that you will see a couple different times in the Avengers series, to bring someone back. This refers to bringing them back from death, in other words, to make them be alive again. This is the sole purpose of the Avengers group at this moment.
So why did you ask the Asgardians down there how much my help is worth? The ones that are left, anyway.
I think we could bring them back.
Stop.
Use them to bring everyone back.
Just like that.
Yeah, just like that.
This expression emphasizes something that happens very quickly or easily.
My mother is selling the house I grew up in. All of my childhood memories gone. Just like that.
That sucks.
In this case, the idea of defeating Thanos, taking the stones from him, and then bringing everybody back with them sounds like a simple task. Banner asking, just like that, shows he doubts it'll be that easy. Then, notice Captain America's tone.
Yeah, just like that.
This shows that tone can sometimes be as effective to communicate an idea as words are.
We laughed, it was a thing, boom, going out tomorrow night.
So, she said yes, just like that?
Just like that.
There's something wrong with her.
Even if there's a small chance that we can undo this, I mean, we owe it to everyone who's not in this room to try.
To undo is to reverse the effects or results of a previous action. For example, you do this on your computer when you want to correct a mistake you just made by pressing Ctrl Z. This word is made up of the verb do and the prefix un.
Thor must strive to undo the damage you have done. He will bring order to the Nine Realms and then, yes, he will be king.
Your stand against organized crime is the first legitimate ray of light in Gotham. Decades. If anyone saw this, everything would be undone. All the criminals you pulled off the streets would be released, and Jim Gordon will have died for nothing.
When you say owe, as in the phrase, owe it to someone, you feel you should do something for someone because they have helped you or given you support. She's probably saying that because everybody has trusted the Avengers to protect the planet from danger. They owe it to the rest of the Avengers to try to do something.
You have another father, too, who gave you another name. And he sent you here for a reason, Clark. And even if it takes you the rest of your life, you owe it to yourself to find out what that reason is.
Hey Avengers fam, we have another lesson teaching you with Avengers Infinity War. I highly recommend that you watch that after you finish this lesson.
If we do this, how do we know it's going to end any differently than it did before?
We're going to review a few common uses of any and then explore the specific use it has in the phrase any different. First, you may know when to use it to mean indefinite qualities, as in, do you have any brothers or sisters?
Simple. Any questions?
Another extremely common use of any is to mean it doesn't matter which, as in,
find the orb, any means, any price.
Now, when he says any differently then, he's using any in a comparative sense. So we use any with comparative adjectives or adverbs. Example, this is an expensive computer, but it's not any better than my old one. I'll see if we can go any faster.
The first 43 parallel universes I've checked proved to be empty. I see no reason to suspect universe number 44 will be any different.
Hey, new girl. Everybody in this room is about that superhero life.
If you say someone is about that life, you're saying that that person has a lifestyle that's different than most people's. You also probably mean that their lifestyle involves things like sex, drugs, and violence. Often you'll hear this in the negative. You're not about that life, as in, if he wants to compete in the Olympics, he'll have to train extremely hard and be extraordinarily disciplined. I'm just not sure he's about that life. What he meant in this scene is that all the Avengers lead lives that are like those of superheroes.
And if you don't mind my asking, where the hell have you been all this time?
We say this to ask something in a polite way. You can say, if you don't mind my asking, plus a question, or I hope you don't mind my asking, but...
So if you don't mind me asking, do you think you might start dating again?
It's much too soon for that. Why, do you know someone?
Okay, great. If you don't mind my asking, why are you guys getting rid of it?
We're getting divorced. I cheated on her for a really long time with a mutual friend.
What he says is funny though, because he follows the polite way to ask a question with a rather rude question. This part is polite, but this part is rather rude, especially because of the word hell. Let's now take a look at the pronunciation of this utterance, as it's full of features of connected speech.
And if you don't mind my asking, where the hell have you been all this time?
We're going to say this as if it's one word.
And if you don't mind,
we omit this sound and say an-nih, then this F links with you, few. Here, we relax the articulation of both these sounds. Let's hear it.
And if you don't mind my asking,
In the second part of this utterance, the key part is this. Have is reduced to of, so have you been turns into have you been.
And if you don't mind my asking, where the hell have you been all this time?
And if you don't mind my asking, where the hell have you been all this time?
There are a lot of other planets in the universe.
Here we'll focus on a lot of, which far from sounding like that in natural speech, we often will say a lot of, as Captain Marvel did here, or even just a lot of.
There's still a lot of unanswered questions and...
You and me, we're a lot alike in a lot of ways.
There are a lot of other planets in the universe.
He used the stones again.
Hey, we'd be going in shorthanded, you know?
Look, he's still got the stones, so...
So let's get him. Use them to bring everyone back.
Just like that.
Yeah, just like that.
Even if there's a small chance that we can undo this, I mean, we owe it to everyone who's not in this room to try.
If we do this, how do we know it's going to end any differently than it did before?
Because before you didn't have me.
Hey, new girl. Everybody in this room is about that superhero life. And if you don't mind my asking, where the hell have you been all this time?
There are a lot of other planets in the universe.
And unfortunately, they didn't have you guys.
I like this one. Let's go get this son of a bitch.
My dress. I can't go in this dress. Can you mend it?
Mend it? No, I'll turn it into something new.
Oh, no, please don't. This was my mother's. And I'd like to wear it when I go to the palace. It's almost like taking her with me.
I understand. But she wouldn't mind if I geared half of it? Wouldn't mind a nice blue?
What's up, global citizens? I'm Ollie, and today we are learning English with the classic story of Cinderella. Now, there are many different versions of this fairy tale, but one of the most well-known is the animation from Disney from the 1950s. And did you know that in 2015 it was made into a movie? If you've seen this movie, let me know in the comments below. In this lesson, we're going to watch two scenes from the 2015 movie, and I'm going to teach you some vocabulary. And then at the end, you're going to have the opportunity to watch the two scenes without subtitles, and I'm going to quiz you with some questions. So make sure you watch all of this lesson to test yourself at the end. It's really simple. All you need to do is hit that subscribe button and the bell down below so you don't miss any of our new lessons. Cinderella tells the story of an orphan girl who is made a servant by her stepmother and stepsisters. One day, the king invites all the single ladies in the kingdom to come to a ball so that the prince can choose one to be his wife. In hopes to attend the ball, Cinderella, along with the help of the house mice, fix an old dress of her late mother. But then...
I don't want to ruin anything. I don't even want to meet the prince.
Oh, and you won't. Because there's no question if you're going.
But... all of the maidens of the land are invited, by order of the king.
Maiden is a word used to describe an unmarried young woman. Cinderella is a beautiful and kind maiden. Because of that, her stepmother keeps Cinderella as busy as she can, fearing she will be the center of attention at the ball, and her daughters won't be able to have the chance to meet the prince. So when she says, "This is no question if you're going," she means that there's no chance, no possibility of her going to the ball.
You must find the maiden that belongs to that sweet voice!
Oh no, come back, sire! No,
personage is used to describe distinct, famous, or important people, such as the king. When speaking about the importance of the event, Cinderella's stepmother disdains her dress, calling it old rags. Rags is a word used to refer to clothes that are visibly old and torn, like these.
Mother, I don't see why everybody else seems to have such nice things to wear, and I always end up in these old rags.
Another way of using this word is in the expression from rags to riches. This means that someone who grew up in poverty now has great wealth. We can even use it to describe Cinderella's story. Cinderella is a rags to riches tale of a servant girl who becomes a princess.
Sorry to have to tell you, but your mother's taste was questionable. This thing is so old-fashioned, it's practically falling to pieces. The shoulder's frayed.
Oh,
it's falling to bits.
It's a ridiculous old-fashioned joke.
If someone has questionable taste, it means the things that this person likes or wears are not socially acceptable or are quite different and distinct from everyone else. So when Cinderella's stepmother says that her dress is so old-fashioned, she means that her dress is not contemporary and that Cinderella's style is not fashion in modern-day society. You can also use old-fashioned to describe someone who has old and outdated ideas. Frayed is used to describe clothes that are worn at the edges, especially if they are old or were worn many times. You use falling to pieces or falling to bits to describe something that is being physically ruined. The stepmother and the sisters say this as they destroy Cinderella's dress. However, you can also use this expression when someone is emotionally unstable or very upset.
My hula career is falling to pieces, and you're worried about stink and work?
How could you? How could I otherwise? I will not have anyone associate my daughters with you. It would ruin their prospects to be seen arriving with a ragged servant girl. Because that is what you are. And that is what you will always be.
How could you is a phrase used to express surprise or strong disapproval of another person's behaviour or actions.
Dear. Oh, how frightfully upsetting. Had I but known.
What do you mean?
Sadly, the boy's sentence has already been carried out.
What sentence?
Death by beheading.
No.
I am exceedingly sorry, Princess.
How could you?
I will not have anyone associate my daughters with you.
What does associate mean in this context? A. To connect. B. To compete. C. To agree. That's right. To be associated with someone is to be connected and to have a relationship with that person. It could be a family, friend, or business relationship. Cinderella's stepmother says that by having her daughters connected to her would ruin the girl's chances of becoming a part of the royalty. The reason for that is because Cinderella is a servant, that is, someone who does domestic services for another person. Servant is not a common word these days, so you will hear servants being referred to as attendants or domestic workers.
Her stepmother and stepsisters ever misused her. By and by, they considered Ella less a sister than a servant.
Now mark my words, you shall not go to the ball.
Shall is quite a formal word used to say that something certainly will or must happen. For example, your English teacher might tell you to do your homework. You could say, I shall do it. You are therefore telling your teacher that you will definitely do it. It is important to note that shall is quite an old-fashioned word.
Shall we?
Ball is a large social gathering for dancing. Cinderella's stepmother wants to make clear that she won't allow Cinderella to go to the ball, so she says, mark my words. This expression can be used when you want the person to pay attention and remember what you are saying.
By the unholy powers vested in me, I banish you with a curse. Mark my words, you and your family will die within the fortnight.
If you love Disney movies, then make sure you check out this playlist. We've made lessons with Ratatouille, Maleficent, Soul, and much more. So, despite her stepmother forbidding her to go to the ball, Cinderella is helped by the house animals and the fairy godmother, and eventually makes it to the ball. Importantly, she must return to her house by midnight. Otherwise, the people at the ball will realize that she is not a royal personage. And can you imagine? Her stepmother would be outraged if she sees her there. While at the ball, she dances with the prince. However, when the clock strikes 12, she runs out of the palace, leaving behind only a crystal slipper.
Who are you?
I am Cinderella. Your Majesty. I'm no princess. I have no carriage, no parents, no dowry.
Cinderella had no one to look after her, and she also had no access to her family's money as her stepmother made her a servant. For that reason, she couldn't offer anything of value to their marriage. In some cultures it was, and still is, customary for the bride's, the woman's, family to pay an amount of money or give a property to the prospective husband prior to marriage. This is called dowry.
Oh, look at these shoes. Where did you get these?
They're Danielle's dowry for her wedding.
Cinderella married.
I do not even know if that beautiful slipper will fit.
Cinderella's glass slippers are an important part of the story. As she loses one in a hurry to leave the ball before midnight, the shoe becomes the only piece of evidence for the prince to find her. The slippers, in this context, are easy to wear shoes. Nowadays, you can use the word slippers to describe these types of shoes. Did you notice that she didn't contract the words do and not? You can hear the word do and not clearly. As the story is set in the past, they speak in a quite posh way. You can also hear how she connects the T from not with the E from even. But in connected fast speech, these two words often become one word, don't. Americans tend to omit the T sound in a sentence. So they would probably say, I don't even know. And they would connect the N sound with the E from even. I don't even know. Compare how the word don't is pronounced differently in these examples.
Shut up. You're gonna get in. Don't even pretend to think otherwise.
You don't even realize how lucky you are never to know what it is to grow old.
But if it does, will you take me as I am? An honest country girl who loves you.
Country is the region away from the big cities. Country girl then refers to a girl from a rural, pastoral area.
So I'm a country girl, I love the trees and the flowers.
Here, Cinderella reminds the prince that she's poor and not sophisticated like other young women from the court. That's why she says, take me as I am, which means accept me for who I am. This is said often in the context of a romantic relationship, to tell the other person that you might not have all the qualities and characteristics she or he expects. If you want to learn more about connected speech, then I highly recommend our Fluent with Friends course.
Of course I will. But only if you will take me as I am. An apprentice still learning his trade. Please.
Trade is used to refer to a job that demands special training. An apprentice is a person who is still learning from a more experienced person the skills to perform a certain job. Common trade jobs include a carpenter, an electrician, a mechanic, etc.
But you're no apprentice.
I am an apprentice monarch, still learning my trade.
Oh, gosh.
Besides, my master has me working tonight.
Then go to Da Vinci. Surely a painter can see another painter.
I am but an apprentice, and he is the greatest painter in the world.
But only if you will take me as I am.
Here, we have two examples of how words can link together. First, you can notice that he connects the words but and only, making it sound but only. The word but will often connect with the next word if it starts with a vowel sound. Note that in American English, it sounds more like this, but only. The T sound becomes a D sound. Try to say these sentences connecting but with the words that come next. Repeat after me. I may come with you, but I'm not sure. He tried reading this novel, but after a while, he gave up. I'm trying to help, but if she doesn't say, I'll never know. Did you notice how my Australian pronunciation is similar to American pronunciation? While Brits would say, but only, for Americans and Australians, the T becomes a flap T, which sounds like a D sound. But only. Try and say it. But only. Then we have the word as connecting with I, becoming as I. Notice that although as is spelled with S, this letter sounds like Z, as. Pronouncing it with an S sound may cause some confusion because the word ass means something completely different. Alrighty, do you remember at the start I said you're going to have a quiz? Well, it's time for that. So we're going to watch the two scenes again without subtitles, and there's going to be a couple of questions in there that you will need to answer. Let me know if you get all the questions correct down in the comments below. And don't forget to hit that subscribe button and the bell down below so you don't miss any of our new lessons.
I don't want to ruin anything. I don't even want to meet the prince.
Oh, and you won't. Because there's no question if you're going.
But all of the maidens of the land are invited by order of the king.
It is the king I'm thinking of. It would be an insult to the royal personage to take her to the palace dressed in these old rags.
Rags? This was my mother's.
Oh, I'm sorry to have to tell you, but your mother's taste was questionable. This thing is so old-fashioned.
Old-fashioned is the opposite of A, outdated, B, contemporary, C, unfinished.
It's practically falling to pieces. The shoulder's frayed.
No way you're leaving home wearing this frayed shirt. Which picture best represents the meaning of frayed?
Oh, it's falling to bits.
It's a ridiculous old-fashioned joke.
How could you?
How could I otherwise? I will not have anyone associate my daughters with you. It would ruin their prospects to be seen arriving with a ragged servant girl. Because that is what you are. And that is what you will always be. Now mark my words. You shall not go to the ball.
Who are you?
I am Cinderella. Your Majesty, I'm no princess. I have no carriage, no parents, no dowry. I do not even know if that beautiful slipper will fit, but if it does, will you take me as I am? An honest country girl who loves you.
Of course I will. But only if you will take me as I am. An apprentice still learning his trade.
What would be another word for trade? A, task. B, hobby. C, job.